Hello, Kevin Bacon again. Kind of hard to wave behind here. Listen, I'm getting a lot of comments on my excuse me, stoves about dimensions and how they're going to affect the performance of the stove. And some of these comments seem to get into a lot of mathematical detail. And so what I wanted to do was to, and in fact I promised I would, put out a video with some real general characteristics, and then perhaps we can get some people to build these things that might not otherwise build them because they look too complicated. First of all, it is not rocket science, it's rocket stove. Okay? I understand that the fellow that came up with the basic premises for all this stuff was an engineer. And I think that he came up with a phenomenal idea, but as a lot of engineers, and don't get mad at me if you're an engineer, but a lot of engineers overthink a problem. And once I got the basic principle in my brain, then I didn't have to use measurements and mathematics and a bunch of stuff to come up with stoves that work. I tried a few. I found out that if you get much smaller than a 3-inch pipe on a rocket stove, you can't put much fuel in it. So if you can't put much fuel in it, you can't get much flame out. Although I made them as small as 1.5 inches and they still work. So, space heater. What is critical? Critical is you gotta have enough space above the chimney. Everything's backwards here. To the top, between here and here, to be larger than the volume of air that's coming out here. So, if this has 16 cubic inches of volume, you got to make sure you've got 16 inches cubes of volume between the top of the stove and the sides of the stove all the way around the outside to allow it get out. Bigger is better. So my stove is very narrow, which means that the flow from down below to up turns around and goes down and comes out the exhaust quite quickly because it doesn't have time to hesitate and stir around. If this barrel had been, say, this wide, it would release more heat before it went out the bottom. Here, before it went out the exhaust. I'm still getting an efficient enough system that it's really not that important. The tank was free, so I used it. It's thick wall also. It's 3/16. Most barrels are quite a bit thinner than that, so it doesn't dissipate the heat to the outside quite as fast. Okay. I'm gonna change my angle so I can look at this. Okay. Distance from here to here, it's better if it's a little bit farther than if it's real short. If it's too short, you're not going to get enough draw on it. So mine happens to be about, excuse me, 3 feet. But remember, the smaller rocket stoves that I'm building are only 1 foot and they still work. Uh-oh, there's the key. They still work. Okay? Maybe not to absolute optimum efficiency, but I don't care. The thing is that I'm burning trash wood for that I pick up for free. I'm getting heat for free out of a system that I built most of it for free. Now, the amount of insulation on the outside of this tube is more critical than all of those diameters. I want to make sure that I've got enough insulation so I'm not losing a lot of heat left to right out of this pipe before it gets to the top. Otherwise, it's not going to siphon as well. So I have about an inch in there of perlite. I wrapped one with exhaust insulation, exhaust pipe wrap for motorcycle exhaust pipes, and it seemed to work, but it does allow quite a bit of heat. A double wrap would be better. So if the only insulation you've got available is that fiberglass or rock glass wrap, wrap two wraps of it around there, which will give you maybe a half an inch, and it'll probably work. Okay, once you get this siphon going, the big thing is this burn chamber down here needs to be extremely well insulated. In fact, when my stove is burning full blast and everything in here is bright red hot, I put my hand on the outside of the stove out here and it's cool as cucumber. That's important. We want that temperature in here to be able to maintain and stay hot without losing its heat, because that's where all the energy goes. That's where the wood that gasifies out here burns hot enough to burn the carbon dioxide up, or carbon monoxide up, and burning the carbon monoxide and burning the hydrogen and everything else in this chamber means what we get coming out the exhaust is clean. Much less hazard. I'm not going to stick my face in it and breathe it. I think that would be ridiculous. But it's kind of like catalytic converter on your car. Get that carbon monoxide to burn, because we want the energy from burning that carbon monoxide. We want the energy from burning the hydrogen. Any of the creosotes that come out of the wood need to burn in this chamber. And I'm burning some waste oil. Remember, I have a drip oiler coming down here. I want it to vaporize and burn right here so that when the exhaust comes out the chimney up at the top and some of it turns around and comes back in the open door of my shop, it doesn't smell like an old tire burning. Okay, so more space around the outside in volume than space here in volume. I'd like to see it double. Bigger than double is better. You can figure all that stuff out, but it's easier just to say, well, okay, this is a 4-inch pipe coming up here. I got 2 inches on each side. I got it licked. I'm at least big enough. I got 3 inches. I got it licked. Okay. I got 1 inch. Ooh, that might be a little questionable. Okay. I got a 4-inch stack. Then I want a couple of inches up here so that I have at least the same amount of space as the diameter of this chimney, so that it has at least that. Man, I like twice that much. I like for it to hit up here and have twice as much room, because all that does for me is allows this to escape faster. Once it gets out here and starts to cool down, it's going to shrink tremendously, because we burn all the oxygen out of the air, or most of it, down here. When we burn the oxygen out of the air shrinks. It is, in fact, I'll make a video about that, shrinking air, on combustion. So it shrinks tremendously. And that's why the exhaust coming out the bottom down here exhausts so slowly. There's a blast of air coming in over here, but there's just a real gentle push out this side, because the volume of the air has dropped from the, 21% oxygen down here is now missing. So it's dropped by perhaps, 25%? You have 25% less volume going out the stack than you do coming in, plus the fact that we superheated it here, which made it expand tremendously coming up the hill. So it has its heat of expansion shrunk down to the same as what it was, or close to where it came in. And we've taken the oxygen out of it. So the exhaust should be somewhere in the neighborhood of 25% less or close to it than what came in. Anyway, I hope that helps. Don't overthink this stuff. Just make sure that you've got the basic common sense things taken care of. If you've got a 4-inch pipe coming in, you've got to have at least 4-inch pipe volume going out. Otherwise, you're going to get clogged up. If you've got 5 or 6-inch pipe volume going out, you're probably better. Okay? And that's about all. And I've learned this by experimenting with all kinds of different stuff. I put a stack on the chimney going out that was 10 feet tall and hooked on tight. Oh my, did it increase the draft in the thing. The only problem is it burned up wood a lot faster and I was sending hot air out the chimney. I don't want to send hot air out the chimney. I want to send the hot air into my shop. So I would rather have a slower exhaust that's not super drafting and get more efficiency, get more of the heat into my shop, than waste the wood heat going up the chimney. I hope that makes some sense. So that's why at the bottom, everything's backwards. At the bottom here, where the elbow turns and goes up, I basically have a barometric break. The two pipes don't fit. So the heat causes it to draft and go up, but it doesn't siphon up. So it's not putting a big draw on my stove. In tall houses years ago, when they had the coal furnaces and the wood furnaces in the basement, in order to keep the chimney from just rip-roaring drafting and the fire from running away with itself, they put a barometric damper in the chimney. And the barometric damper was basically a flap with a weight on it that could be adjusted so that as the draft increased, the flap would open, it would take fresh air into the chimney, and it would cut down on the draft pulling in the stove. Okay? So, that's a consideration to make also. Anyway, that's basically some things that I've learned, and I really, really enjoy reading your comments because it shows you're thinking about these things, and there are people out here that are actually going to build these things. And I'm thinking, you know, for all you preppers and everybody else out there that are building tin can stoves for their bug out locations and all that kind of stuff, they work great, but you know, I can get a handful of twigs and pile them in my shop and burn for hours on a handful of twigs. And this thing puts out a lot of heat. Is it rip-roaring red hot on the outside? No, it's not. But it could be if I increased some of the dimensions a little bit. It could be. The wood chamber and everything coming down, considering the size of the tank, I'm stuck. But if I had a bigger around tank, I could have a bigger around wood chamber, a bigger around pipe on the inside. Now, the only one thing that I can tell you that would be a problem is if you reach a point where this chimney coming up is so big around that it can start to swirl in here instead of drafting properly, that could be a problem. And then I'm thinking you're probably like, okay, you got a 55-gallon drum or a 20-gallon drum in here for your chimney. Your air is probably going to enter here and just run up one side and not be real efficient because it doesn't want to push that volume. It's not going to get the siphon effect. But most of you aren't going to build stoves that big. And if you were, then that would have to be like 2 barrels high. Then it would probably work. But then you're getting into all kinds of physics and stuff, and I just don't think it's necessary. Test your components before you put it together, and you're going to find that this burn chimney worked just wonderfully well without the barrel on it. Insulated in the whole works, without the top on it, before I glued the top on it, it worked wonderfully well. I mean, it was hot enough to melt aluminum in there without any problem at all down in these lower ranges down here. That's hot. Okay? Then I put the top on it, and we lost some of the heat, but we got it all because I can put my hand on this exhaust with the stove going full blast. Okay, sorry, I played with the zoom there a little bit. Here, let's give you a little bit of a dizzy there. Woo. There we go. Okay, Kevin Bacon, goodbye. I hope that helped. And you know, by all means, keep these discussions going because we're all learning something by listening and by reading what we see. I want to see some videos on these stoves now, guys. You're building stoves. I'm not seeing your stoves. Come on, come on. All right, Kevin Bacon, bye.